Okay, so as I already told you that in order to turn off the conducting thyristor, the two things are very, very important. First one is that there has to be a reverse bias should be maintained across that conducting thyristor, as well as the current flowing through it should be reduced to zero. So when these two conditions will be met, a conducting thyristor will be turned off. Okay, so here we are going to discuss about various techniques through which we can turn off a conducting thyristor. त्या केबलला कनेक्ट होते बघू. ओके बघते एकच मिनिट. हा याचा पेन आहे. 2 मिनिटं चेक करते होते का ते. होते कनेक्ट झालं. थँक्यू. चालेल. ओके थँक्यू. ओके so let us discuss various commutation techniques of the ACR. Okay, so in order to turn off a thyristor, the process of turning off the thyristor is called as a commutation. Okay, so now in order to commutate or turn off a conducting thyristor, first of all, we need to apply reverse bias. Across that conducting thyristor, and then we need to reduce the current flowing through the thyristor equals to zero. Reduce the current flowing through the thyristor to zero. Okay, so based on this, there are different techniques through which we can commutate a conducting thyristor. So first one is called as line commutation, which is also called as natural commutation. Then there is load commutation. Then third one is forced commutation, and there is external pulse commutation. So these are the various techniques of commutating a conducting thyristor. Okay, Now all these techniques, line commutation, load commutation, post commutation and external pulse commutation, they have been categorized further. All of these are classified as class A, class B, class C, class D and class E and class F commutation. So all these four commutation techniques have been categorized as class A, class B, class C, class D, class E and class F commutation techniques. So we are going to study them in detail. What do we mean by line commutation, load commutation, post commutation or external pulse commutation with the help of these different commutation techniques which are class A through class F commutation. Okay, so we'll start discussing first of all line commutation, which is also called as a class F commutation. Okay, the easiest one, first of all we'll look at the class F commutation technique. Which is basically a line commutation or also called as a natural commutation. Okay, so as you can see here in this class F commutation technique, the source voltage is AC voltage. Okay, source voltage is nothing but AC source. So this is called as a line commutation. Okay, so this is called as a line. Why? Because the source is sinusoidal in nature, line voltage. Now here we need to draw the waveform so that we will be able to understand how does it operate. First of all, we'll draw the input voltage. Okay, now we know that when the thyristor will be turned on, when it will be forward bias, the thyristor will be turned on when first of all it needs to be forward biased, and second thing is that we need to apply some gate signal, right? Gate voltage should be applied to the gate terminal. Okay, so here if you see here, this is anode, this is the cathode terminal, and this terminal is the gate terminal. Here the triggering circuit has not been shown. Okay, we'll have to assume that there is a triggering circuit available so that the gate voltage will be applied to its gate terminal. Okay, just we have shown here the source voltage for the circuitry. Now so here the second thing is that I'll draw the gate pulse here. Now The thyristor will be forward biased during the positive half cycles of the input. So in each half cycle, we'll apply this gate signal like this, right? Okay, so this is the gate signal that we need to apply. Now, during the positive half cycle of this input, this thyristor T will be forward biased. Okay, so at omega T is equal to 0, if we apply triggering signal to its gate terminal, then this thyristor will be turned on. So once it is turned on, it will conduct, it will act as a short circuit and current will flow through the load. Okay, now since the load is resistive in nature, it will follow the supply voltage variations continuously. So the load voltage here is like this, that is the positive half cycle will appear as it is across this load terminal. Okay, as soon as we apply triggering signal to its gate terminal at omega t is equal to 0. See here, during the positive half cycle of the input, the thyristor will be forward biased. During this condition, if we apply the triggering signal to its gate terminal at omega t is equal to 0, this thyristor T will be turned on and it will conduct and carry the load current. Here, the load voltage, the voltage available across load is same as that of the input voltage, that is the positive half cycle. And at the same time, since the load is resistive in nature, it will follow the supply voltage variations. Okay, and this is nothing but what? Load current, which is VL upon R. Okay, and this is nothing but what? The load voltage. Okay, at omega t is equal to pi, what happens? The supply voltage will reverse its polarity. See here, at omega t is equal to pi, the supply voltage reverses its polarity, because of which the thyristor T will be reverse biased. At the same instant, the current, load current, has also reduced to zero. So because of these two natural conditions, that is, the supply voltage has been reduced, the supply voltage has been reversed, as well as the load current has been reduced to zero, this thyristor T will be turned off. So at omega T is equal to pi, the thyristor will be turned off. It will act as an open circuit. Okay, so there won't be any current flowing through the load, and the load voltage will be zero, as well as the load current will also be zero. Even though the gate signal is available at omega t is equal to pi, the thyristor has been reverse biased because of the natural reversal of the supply voltage, as well as the current flowing through has been reduced to zero, the thyristor will be turned off naturally. So because of these two things, this commutation technique is called as what? It is a natural commutation. Have you understood this? Everyone got this or not? Karte ka sagalana? See, this is the simplest commutation technique. Class F commutation, which is nothing but a line commutation, or also called as a natural commutation. Kindly reply so that I'll be able to understand whether you are getting this or not. Only Vinod has answered. What about others? They are not getting a what? okay. So this is what is called as a class F commutation, also called as a natural commutation or line commutation. Okay, again in the next positive half cycle at omega t is equal to 2 pi, what will happen? This thyristor T will be powered by us. At this omega t is equal to 2 pi, if we apply a triggering signal to its gate terminal at omega t is equal to 2 pi, it will be turned on and it will carry the load current. So the load voltage will be available across the load side. Okay, here. Will be the load current. Okay, so in this way we can the thyristor has been commutated naturally because the supply voltage is AC. Okay, because the supply source voltage is AC source, the thyristor has been commutated naturally. That is why this commutation, class F commutation technique, is nothing but natural commutation or line commutation. Okay, so this is the one of the commutation techniques of the thyristor. Now the next commutation technique is class A commutation technique, which is also called as a load commutation. Okay, आता पहिला कम्युटेशन टेक्निक आपण बघितलं, विच वॉज लाईन कम्युटेशन और नॅचरल कम्युटेशन, वेअर द सोर्स वोल्टेज वॉज ए सी. बट वॉट विल हॅपन इफ द सोर्स वोल्टेज इज डी सी? इफ द सोर्स वोल्टेज इज डी सी, देन रिव्हर्सल ऑफ सप्लाय वोल्टेज as well as current reducing to zero is not possible, right? Current supply voltage apply DC hai. Supply voltage DC hai. Tita reversal pan hot nahi, kiwa current apna zero pan hot nahi. Asha ves kay karaycha? At that time we shall go for this classic commutation, which is also called as a load commutation. Means what? For a known value of load resistor R, here in such cases when the source voltage is DC and so that there is no reversal of supply voltage as well as the current cannot reduce to zero, at that time for a known value of a load resistor, for a known value of load resistor R, components like inductor and capacitor have been selected, inductor L and capacitor C, are selected so that the circuit will resonate. So if the circuit resonates, it will create oscillations, right? It will create oscillations. When there are oscillations, If the circuit is resonated, then there will be oscillations like this, right? Based upon the parameters L and C selected. So, if the circuit resonates and if it creates the oscillations, then as you can see here, the reversal of the supply voltage is possible. Right, as well as the current can also be reduced to zero. So this commutation technique is called as a load commutation, where the source voltage available is DC source, where because of the DC source, the reversal of supply voltage as well as the current cannot be reduced to zero. That condition is not possible for us. So for in order to commutate a conducting thyristor, for the known value of the load resistor R, we need to select commutating components in like a inductor and capacitor, so that the circuit will resonate and it will create the oscillations. If it creates the oscillations, then it is possible to have the reversal of the supply voltage as well as the current can be reduced to zero. So these two conditions can be achieved if we select the commutating components like inductor and capacitor for a known value of a resistor R. Okay, why? Because the source is DC. And we are not having the reversal of supply as well as the current to zero, current to be reduced to zero. Okay, fine. So now we'll study how we can have or how we can achieve the commutation in this particular technique. Okay. Okay, now we are going to see two different configurations where the load has been connected in series with these commutating components L and C in series when the value of load resistor is low, and when the value of load resistor is high, at that time that load resistor will be connected in parallel with the capacitor. Okay, so first of all, let us study this first connection. Now here for the load value R, the commutating components L and C have been selected in such a way that the circuit will be underdamped. Okay, here the values of L and C have been selected in such a way that the circuit will be underdamped. So the oscillations will be created like this. Okay, now see here, the source voltage is DC. Now in order to create the oscillations, we have committed used commutating components L and C in such a way that the circuit will be underdamped and the oscillations will be created. Okay, now when we have connected a circuit like this, when we apply gate signal to this thyristor T at T is equal to 0, it will be turned on. Okay, it will be turned on and it will carry the current like this. So the current will start flowing through this load. It will start increasing, attain its peak, and then after attaining its peak, it will reduce to 0. Now during this process, the capacitor will start charging. The capacitor will start charging like this, and we have selected it in such a way that the capacitor will be charged beyond the supply voltage to E. So now when the current has been reduced to 0, at that time the potential available across this capacitor is almost 2E. Now because of these two conditions, the current has been reduced to 0 as well as the voltage across this capacitor is equal to 2E, the thyristor will be commutated. Why? Because its cathode potential will be higher than its anode potential. When the capacitor has been charged beyond the supply voltage E, at that time the cathode potential will be at higher side as compared to its anode potential, and also the current flowing through the thyristor has been reduced to 0. Because of these two conditions, the thyristor will be turned off. Okay. Have you understood this? Okay, so this is the one thing through which we can commutate a thyristor. Now, in the same commutation technique, when the load is high, the value of load is high, at that time we need to connect it across the capacitor. Now, how we can do that? Okay, now what will happen when the load has been connected across this capacitor? See, now first of all, we need to apply gate signal to this thyristor so that it will be turned on. It is forward biased, of course, but we need to apply some gate current to it. Okay, now when we apply gate signal to this thyristor, it will be turned on. So at say T is equal to T1, when we apply the triggering signal to this gate terminal of this thyristor, it will be turned on. So once it is turned on, current will start flowing through this circuit. Okay, and because of which so So this load current will get divided as I1 and I2 like this. The total current will divide like I1 and I2. Now because of this, the capacitor will start charging. So when we will apply triggering signal to this conducting thyristor, it will act as a short circuit and current will start flowing through the device, through the load. Okay. Now the capacitor will start charging towards the supply voltage. Rather, we have selected it in such a way that the capacitor will be charged beyond the supply voltage E. Now, so when this thyristor will be turned on, current will start flowing through it. It will attain its peak value and then it will be reduced to zero when the voltage of, when the capacitor will be charged beyond the supply voltage E. Now, when the voltage across this capacitor is greater than the supply voltage, at that time the thyristor will be reverse biased as well as the current flowing through it will be reduced to zero. Now this capacitor will start discharging through this load. At this particular instant, the thyristor will be turned off. At t is equal to t1, thyristor has been turned on. So once the thyristor has been turned on, the current will start flowing through this circuit, because of which the capacitor will start charging towards the supply voltage E. Rather, it will be charged beyond the supply voltage E. Now when the voltage across this, when the capacitor will be charged beyond the supply voltage E, the current flowing through this thyristor will be reduced to zero, as well as the cathode potential of this potential at its cathode terminal will be higher than its anode potential, therefore the thyristor will be turned off. Now because of these two conditions, the thyristor will be turned off at this particular instant. Okay, at this particular instant, the thyristor will be turned off, say at t is equal to t2. So at t is equal to t1, thyristor was turned on. At t is equal to t2, when the capacitor voltage is higher than the supply voltage, as well as when the current flowing through the circuit has been reduced to zero, the thyristor will be turned off. Now once the thyristor has been turned off, the capacitor will start discharging through this load. Now as soon as the voltage across this capacitor falls below the supply voltage E, the thyristor will be forward biased once again. When the voltage across the capacitor exceeds the supply voltage E, at that time thyristor was reverse biased. But when the voltage across the capacitor falls below the supply voltage E, the thyristor will be forward biased. At that instant, if we again apply the triggering signal to this thyristor, it will be turned on. But now here, the thyristor will be turned on. The capacitor will start charging with some initial voltage, say V0. So again, at this instant, if we again apply triggering signal to this thyristor, which is forward biased, when it was forward biased, when the voltage across the capacitor falls below the supply voltage E. Now, if we apply triggering signal once again at this instant, say t is equal to t3, the thyristor will be turned on and again it will carry the current. Again, capacitor will start charging. Okay, so the load current will also start to flow. It will attain its peak and then again it will be reduced to zero. So likewise, once the current reduces to zero, once the voltage across this capacitor exceeds the supply voltage, the current will be reduced to zero. The current flowing through the thyristor will be reduced to zero, as well as since the voltage across the capacitor is greater than the supply voltage, this thyristor will be reverse biased and it will be turned off at t is equal to t4. So again, the capacitor will start discharging through this load. So this process will be continued. Have you understood the operation of this class A commutation technique? Hello everyone, have you understood this or not? Okay. So if you have understood, we will stop here today. So today we have discussed two commutation techniques, class A commutation, which is a load commutation, and class F commutation, which is the natural commutation. Why it is called as a natural commutation? Because the source voltage is AC. Because of this AC source voltage, there will be a reversal of the supply voltage as well as the current will be reduced to zero. That because of these two natural conditions, the thyristor gets turned off naturally. And in class A commutation, when the source voltage is DC, there is no reversal of the supply voltage as well as the reduction of the current to zero. Because of that, we need to use some extra components in that circuitry. We need to use some extra components like inductor and capacitor so that the circuit will resonate and it will create the oscillations. Because of those oscillations created, the reversal of the supply voltage will be also there, as well as the current flowing through the circuit will be reduced to zero, and the circuit, the thyristor will be turned off, right? So this was about the load commutation. In the next session, we will discuss about the remaining commutation technique, that is class B, C, D and E. Okay, so today I will stop here. I'll take you leave now. Thank you. Have a nice day.